All right, y'all, I'm gonna get started. I have just a couple of announcements before we start the lecture. The first is, I just wanted to take a moment, we're about a third of the way into the semester, to let you know that if you have feedback along the way regarding the lectures, I would really be happy to hear from you. Just via email or whatever, things that work for you, that you like that are happening, things you wish would happen less or more, or that haven't happened at all that you'd like to see happen, that would be helpful to me going forward. As I told you on the first day, I don't love this format, and I want to make it as effective for you as possible and enjoyable. So let me know about that. The other announcement has to do with two events taking place this week as part of the Trotter Multicultural Center's celebration of Black History Month. And both events are probably, or should be, of interest to you. First of all, Wednesday at 6:30 at the Trotter Center, and I put the map up for you, there's a free screening of a movie a lot of you have probably already seen called Fab Five. It's an ESPN Films documentary about the five freshman basketball players that were recruited to play here in the early 90s, but some members of the team will also be present to be part of a conversation after the screening. So I expect that's going to be pretty crowded. Doors open at 6, and you probably want to get there early. I think they're serving food, too, so that could incentivize this. And then the second event that they're holding is Thursday, also at 6:30, but this one is not at Trotter, but rather in the Robertson Auditorium at Ross. There'll be three former Michigan athletes, Maurice Ways, Ray Jackson, and Braylon Edwards, and there's gonna be a lecture and discussion on the topic of the black male athlete, asking the question, who is he and what is he to you? So I know you all have busy schedules, but I really want to encourage you to attend both events. All right. So we've got a few weeks under our belt now, and it seemed like a good time to me to step back and just take stock of where we've been and where we're at. So for starters, you remember the big picture I laid out in our first lecture 4 weeks ago. I introduced you or suggested to you the metaphor of global sports culture as a machine, the sports machine. That machine, by the way, does nothing. It's actually called the do-nothing machine, which is, I don't know, seemed interesting to me from the point of view of sports as something that both does a lot, because it's obviously doing a lot, but in another sense, doesn't do anything. Anyway, so the sports machine. And I said that in this course, we'd be using a dozen different conceptual lenses to look at different components of that machine, all the while trying to be aware and critically mindful of our habitual ways of thinking about sports. Then I told you that I had organized those 12 lenses into three groups: individual lenses, social lenses, and cultural lenses. And I'd ordered these into a sequence so that we'd work our way from left to right, top to bottom, individual to the social to the cultural. So in a way, the social and cultural are still a ways off. However, you've already been able to see that even when we were looking at a very individual concept like the body, we couldn't avoid considering it from the perspective given by social lenses like the media, markets, and politics, and cultural lenses like images and words, as we did when we were talking about Serena Williams. On the other hand, so all this stuff comes forward kind of at every moment, but on the other hand, while keeping that in mind, remember that I also encouraged you to think of the four individual lenses that I chose to group together at the beginning of the course as referring to four basic components at work when an imaginary individual engages the sports machine. So with that in mind, I began with the body because that seemed to me to be the most fundamental unit or component necessary to engage the sports machine. Then last week, you could think of our exploration of play as a way of setting that body in motion. I'm a really good artist. In ways that may not be exclusive to sports, but that are certainly essential for sports. The sports machine doesn't run without bodies playing and moving in play. In talking about play last week, I emphasized that for me anyway, the most meaningful feature of play was that it was an activity in which we could experience ourselves as free, express our creative freedom, and exercise our practice or our ability to be free. But I also hinted in passing that the freedom we experience in play arises seemingly paradoxically because in play we voluntarily submit to certain unnecessary restrictions or limitations. I think the example I gave last week was that I can't use a brick to knock out my opponent in a boxing match. But even just looking at this very simple, excellent drawing, you can see that there are restrictions on the body that was running in the previous slide. Now, when you watched the teenage Palestinian free runners of PK Gaza, you saw human bodies moving playfully across a mostly decimated, heavily policed urban landscape. The movements you saw were limited by the physiological capacities of their bodies, the laws of physics, the properties of the objects and spaces in their environment, including the social and political restrictions impacting them, and the rules they've set up for themselves, dictating what kinds of movements are permissible and which are forbidden. Through this playful, but also serious, dynamic interaction of freedom and limitation, they transform their movements into sport. So today, I want to go more deeply into the concept of limits. I want to think about different ways that our imaginary individual's engagement with the sports machine entails an encounter with limits of various kinds, and also that for that very reason, it encourages and even demands varied responses to the limits he or she might encounter. So I'm going to start this far from the present with a little etymology. That means word origin. The English word limit comes from a Latin word limes. In ancient Rome, the limes was just a boundary line or marker, like a stream, a road, or a path that marked one agricultural field and separated it from another. But from this original meaning, it came to be applied as the Roman Empire expanded along military roads to a fortified frontier between Roman territory and foreign territory, like on the right. Troops could move along this road, but they weren't supposed to cross the limes, not even the Roman troops. They constructed these as purely defensive measures. They were there, in other words, to keep the enemies out and keep Roman soldiers in, preventing them from wandering into enemy territory. They were not meant to be crossed. And yet, in a certain way, they wouldn't be there if there hadn't been an idea of crossing them. So I'm beginning with this reflection on the word's history because it seems to capture, for me, something that's fascinating about limits in sports, that they seem to fix a boundary, marking off the possible from the impossible, and at the same time to invite participants to strive to cross that boundary. Just as Roman limes were both roads and defensive barriers, just as they both impeded and facilitated movement, so the limits we encounter in sports, it seems to me, both define the possible and encourage the impossible. Sports are structured by rules and laws, physical and otherwise, and by other boundaries, and are designed to invite challenges and even transgression of those boundaries. You can think about it this way. Last week I shared with you this definition of games from philosopher Bernard Suits. Games are the voluntary attempt to overcome unnecessary obstacles. Now in the beginning of the chapter from Heather Reed's book, that the chapter was called Sport and Games that you read for today, she gave you a more detailed version of that definition. But for my purposes today in lecture, I want to use this definition to organize my comments because I think it captures the double-sided character of how I think limits work in sports. Sports present limits in the form of unnecessary obstacles, but participation in sports, and I think to a large degree the appeal for spectators of sports, arises because of the attempt to overcome those obstacles, to cross those limits. So I'll begin by talking a little bit about the unnecessary obstacles specified by the rules of sports. Rules impose limits in terms of space, time, movement, equipment, and competition. But then I want to explore the fact that these limits set by the rules are really only limits because of another set of limits, the physiological and physical limits of the bodies that encounter them. And then finally, even though we haven't gotten to our social lenses yet, I want to be sure to keep sight of the fact that this constellation of limits that's formed by the interaction of rules and bodies and physical law exists in a social fabric that imposes its own limits. But remember, unnecessary obstacles are only one side of suit's definition. In the second part of my lecture, then, I want to focus on what goes into the attempt to overcome those obstacles. There are many elements here, of course, but I'm going to focus on preparation, desire and imagination, and creativity. And then I'm going to turn to a kind of case study in the final section of my remarks. I want to look in detail with you at a particular instance of an individual athlete confronting and overcoming the limits arising in the course of a specific play. So I'm going to begin with space. Most obviously, the rules require a boundary separating in play or in bounds from out of play or out of bounds. Those lines limit the permissible movements of players and define players as either part of the game or not. In addition to the limiting effect of boundary lines, the rules of many sports also designate certain special areas that limit players in various ways: the lane in basketball, base paths, or the batter's box in baseball, the penalty area in soccer, the crease in hockey. Even the moving first down line in American football defines a space of 10 yards that a team must advance within four plays. Of course, the most important of these special spaces are goals. They could simply be a finish line in track or a specified distance in swimming. It could be a specific space within which a puck, a ball, or other object has to enter. In a sport like volleyball, you could think of that goal space as essentially the entire opponent's side of the court. In this way, the rules generate internal differentiation in the strategic value of the space defined by the boundary lines. The space closer to the goal has a higher strategic value than the space farther away from the goal. In some sports, further specific designations respond to this heightened strategic value by limiting the number or the activity of players within areas marked out near the goal, like in goaltending. And in some sports, like tennis, diving, and hurdling, to name just a few, the rules explicitly exploit all three spatial dimensions by bringing the vertical axis into play as a limiting factor. Now, rules can also establish limits by specifying time intervals. The broadest of these intervals is the interval that defines the whole game or match. But in some sports, there are also shorter intervals that exert a pressure on gameplay, like the play clock in American football or the shot clock in basketball. As with the rules that establish spatial limits in sports, the rules defining the unique time frame of sporting events create internal variations in the temporal experience of participants and spectators by heightening the tension as play approaches the edge of one of these limits. Think about the heightened excitement of Hail Mary passes, last second goals, or buzzer beating shots like Trey's. Of course, in racing sports, time also serves as the measure defining achievement. And in many sports, rules more indirectly limit the temporal experience of athletes by demanding timing, which is the way of saying by demanding that they execute certain actions within very, very narrow, variable time frames. So we've got rules defining space and time, and now I want to turn to how rules define the movement and limit the movements of participants as they strive to achieve the goals within those spatial and temporal limits. So on the one hand, rules require that certain actions be undertaken within designated spaces or times, or both. So, for example, a pass must be caught with the receiver's foot in bounds. A basketball player has to leave the lane within 3 seconds. Soccer's offsides rule means that a player must release a pass beyond the defense in the instant just before her teammate races past the imaginary line drawn across the field by the position of the last defender. Make that pass too soon and the defense can recover it. Make it too late and the teammate will be offsides. On the other hand, the spatial and temporal specifications of the rules push the athlete's body towards its limits of strength, speed, agility, or endurance. A marathon stretches the space of running to 26.2 miles, while the temporal framework of a timed competition pushes the athlete toward the limit formed by the combination of endurance and speed. Now, in some sports, rules specify or prohibit the use of certain kinds of equipment. This is the fourth way that rules will impact or set limits. And that equipment dynamically interacts with the limitations imposed on space, time, and movement. The size and weight of objects, balls or shots or pucks, or the properties of certain prosthetic equipment like sticks, rackets, and bats, permitted or required in competition, likewise both impose limits on the participants and push participants toward the edge of certain limits. Skates in hockey speed the action, increasing the force of collisions and decreasing the time players have to react to the unfolding action. And some sports with vertical obstacles or goals that circumscribe the movements allowed to overcome those goals also require special equipment. And that in turn, that equipment imposes new limits, like in pole vaulting. Now, moving from equipment to competition, the rules define what it is to win a game or a match. By defining what must be done to do so, to win a game, in the context of all the other limits, sports bring into being competition between opponents, and these competitors can play a limiting role in relation to one another. Like the other limits I've discussed, the opponents serve sometimes to define and heighten the difficulty of certain tasks, hit the ball where the opponent isn't in baseball, tennis, and volleyball, or as simple barriers preventing the accomplishment of certain tasks, and sometimes as spurs that push the athlete to the limit of their physical and technical capabilities. Now, beyond the specific limits imposed by the rules of sport, the culture of modern sport also creates, by custom, a record of the historical limits of achievement in various sports and events, which is kind of a form of trans-historical competition, competition across time. So the men's world record for running 100 meters is 9.58 seconds. This is probably not an absolute limit on what a human being could accomplish in this event, but it does set the limit for what a human being has accomplished. As such, it forms a kind of physical and imaginative horizon for present and future runners. And like the other limits we have discussed, it encourages attempts to transgress or challenge those limits. Now, the limits imposed by the rules and by records presuppose a human body. That's obvious, as we've already said. There's no sports or sports machine without bodies. But my point here is more specific and maybe a little bit less obvious, that the limits imposed by the rules are partly a function of the limits and capacities of the human body. I'm going to give you an example. Just imagine the effect. You can imagine the effect on the human body of an adjustment in some of the rules defining space, time, movements, equipment, or competition in certain sports. So these are diving platforms, obviously. A 10-meter diving platform gives divers about a second and a half in which to execute complex maneuvers. A dive off a platform just 1 meter off the ground wouldn't yield enough time, not even half a second, to invite the creativity of divers or attract the interest of spectators. On the other hand, imagine if the diving platform were set at 100 meters, about 30 feet higher than Tower Plaza here. Divers would have almost 5 seconds in which to execute a greater number of more complex maneuvers, which would be awesome for those of us watching. Unfortunately for the diver, the increased velocity would turn their impact with the water into a lethal hazard, the equivalent of being hit by a car going 85 miles an hour. Even a diver like the one you just saw a moment ago, jumping from 10 meters, is hitting the water at a speed of over 30 miles an hour. So the limits imposed by the rules must work with the limits of the human body, not to mention the laws of physics, while at the same time challenging athletes to push against those limits. Whatever the nature of the physical limit, strength, speed, size, agility, quickness, durability, or endurance, the rules of sport function in relation to, and sometimes evolve in response to changes in, what a human body can do. Finally, as I said, though we'll have occasion to get into this in much greater detail in the weeks ahead, I want to note here that sports are also impacted by limits that have only an indirect relationship to the rules and the bodies that contend with them, social and cultural limits. The rules of some sports require large expanses of open space. As a result, residents of congested urban areas may be less likely to consider participation in those sports, or if they do, be unable to gain access to the kind of space necessary to participate and develop their abilities. In poor cities or neighborhoods, public facilities may be lacking entirely or in disrepair. Other sports, as a result of the combination of rules and the limits of the human body, require specialized spaces and expensive equipment. So think about hockey. If you live in a poor desert community, you're not likely to have access to ice. But even if you live in a climate where hockey is popular, like say Toronto, your family's poverty may be a limit that discourages or absolutely impedes your access to the sport. No matter how great your potential for it might be or your determination. In other cases, these social factors work in more subtle ways. Many of us who love sports like to imagine it as a meritocracy in which talent and hard work determine success on what we always presume is a level playing field. But of course, even once an athlete gains access to a sport like these Afghan boxers, socioeconomic status may bar them from the best coaching, equipment, or facilities to develop her abilities. More subtly still, cultural prejudices can create limits to access and success in sport by discriminating against athletes on the basis of the color of their skin, their gender, or their sexuality. Sometimes, even when the formal barriers embodying these prejudices no longer absolutely impede participation, the underlying attitudes haven't gone away, and they still set limits on what coaches or fans consider possible for a particular athlete, and even when they are internalized on what an athlete, him or herself, might consider possible. So to play a sport, Suits told us, remember, is to choose to overcome unnecessary obstacles. And I've been thinking of these obstacles and talking about them as limits. We've looked at the ways that the rules, the body, and society can impose various kinds of limits on an imaginary individual getting ready to engage the sports machine as a participant. However, this is just one side of the story. As I suggested at the outset, the limits arising within the sports machine not only serve as barriers, but also as thresholds that encourage movement, a movement across boundaries, a transgression of limits. So I want to turn now to looking at how some of these unnecessary obstacles are overcome. The limits represented by the rules of sport often require, of course, the execution of highly specialized technical maneuvers and equally high levels of strength, quickness, agility, speed, or endurance, or some combination of these. And though not visible to most fans who only see outcomes or performances, probably the most important means by which individuals develop these capacities to overcome limits is training and practice. In his 2008 best-selling study of what he called outliers, popular journalist Malcolm Gladwell summarized some scientific investigations into individuals who had mastered cognitively complex fields like chess, music, or sports. And according to Gladwell, had found that researchers had settled on a magic number of hours of practice required for true expertise. 10,000 hours. As Gladwell and others have noted, that's equal to about 20 hours per week for a decade. Now, some qualifications. That doesn't mean that everyone who puts this amount of time into a sport will become a star or even master the sport. Researchers are still investigating just what that practice has to look like, as well as how other factors, talent, social opportunity, luck, impact the varying outcomes among individuals who have put in that amount of time. But for my purpose here today, the very simple point stands. Extensive, deliberate training and practice are absolutely necessary, even if they are not by themselves sufficient to consistently overcome the obstacles presented to participants in sports. But it's also important to recognize that training and practice already presuppose, and also will develop over time, some indispensable psychological factors like imagination, desire, and determination, to name just three. So think for a second about what is entailed in doing something for 20 hours a week for 10 years, or nearly 3 hours per day. To start by noting that to get your 10 years in while your body is still young enough to compete at an elite level, you probably are no older than around 8, maybe 10, when you set upon this path. Now, though most don't do this, 8-year-olds are supposed to get 10 to 11 hours of sleep a night. Let's say 10 hours for sleep, and let's say another 8 hours a day for school. So that leaves this kid with about 6 hours per day. Now let's say we squeeze 3 meals into an hour and a half a day. Now you've got four and a half hours left in that day. Got to do things like bathe, get dressed, get to and from various places. Depending on where you live, if you got to take public transportation, let's say that could easily take up to an hour or so. Now we've got just 3.5 hours remaining in the day. Assuming that your family doesn't require you to have a job or do any sort of chores around the house, watch younger siblings, that would leave you half an hour after your 3 hours of practice to do things like homework or socialize or watch TV. Oh, sorry. Those 10,000 hours just count the time spent practicing the skills. They don't include participating in or traveling to and from competitions or, especially vital to athletic performance and even more time-consuming, the time spent just training to improve basic physical endurance, strength, speed, balance, and agility. We don't know for sure how much time that requires, but as you can see, and as some of you know very, very well, something will have to give. Maybe it's schoolwork, maybe it's socializing, maybe it's sleep. Chances are it's going to be some of all of these. My point is that becoming an elite athlete takes a big chunk out of your days for a big chunk of years. To take that on, you probably have to possess significant measures of imagination to envision the still far-off results of your investment of time and energy. Desire, not only for those results, but even to some degree for the various practice activities in themselves, and determination to keep you at it when your desire fades or you encounter setbacks. At the same time, the very process by which you put that time into perfecting your craft is also likely to exercise and so to further develop those psychological qualities, desire, imagination, determination. So by the time we encounter, let's say as spectators now, an elite athlete confronting one limit or another in their sport, we are beholden a human being who has invested a significant percentage of their psychological, intellectual, and physical energy, literally of their life, in the voluntary attempt to overcome unnecessary obstacles. By this point in time, by the time we watch them, they've successfully navigated a wide range of challenging situations in their sport. And in this way, they have added experience to the fundamental technical skills and psychological and physical fitness required to succeed. And yet, while certain basics of the sport may come easily to them by comparison with you or me, they are still facing competition from other elite athletes in high-pressure situations. The ability to put all this together and overcome obstacles is what allows a gymnast like Simone Biles to harness her strength, grace, balance, and intelligence into a breathtaking sequence of complex moves in horizontal and vertical space, executed precisely within the stipulated boundaries of the mat during her floor routine. It's what allows Odell Beckham Jr., leaping and falling backward, to fend off an elite defender, keep his eyes on a ball in mid-flight, coordinate his vision with his hands to grasp the object and haul it in while somehow maintaining the presence of mind to keep his feet both inbounds and to cross the goal line. Dribbling a soccer ball through a set of cones might be easier for Lionel Messi than for you or me, or even very good soccer players. But it's still going to be challenging for him to dribble it effectively through a thicket of the world's best defenders while he is also battling fatigue and taking in the state of the game and the abilities and positions of his teammates and of other defenders and processing all this information in a fraction of a second so as to be able to make the best available play. It's within these variable conditions that the best of the best make their sports look easy by combining their athletic ability and skill, honed through years of training and practice and seasoned with experience, with the imagination and courage required to creatively improvise in response to the combination of general fixed limits imposed by the rules and the more dynamically fleeting obstacles popping up in any given moment of competition. Global sports cultures have offered us many such moments. No doubt you all have some of your favorites, and I hope that you'll be thinking about them and maybe also sharing them in the coming week. Speaking for myself, I could watch things like that all day long, but rather than just kind of rip superficially through more images of such moments, I'd rather focus on one specific instance that I especially cherish. It's not the free throw line dunk. The play happened in 3 seconds on Sunday, May 11th, 1980, during game 4 of the NBA Finals between the Philadelphia 76ers and the Los Angeles Lakers. The Lakers at that time were led by rookie Magic Johnson and veteran superstar center Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, who is still today the all-time leading scorer in the NBA. As for the 76ers, they were led by Julius Erving, the same Dr. J whose free throw line dunk a few years before had electrified my imagination. So first I'm going to show you the play.
It's 89-84, Sixers, and they get inside. And unbelievable, Julius Erving. Watch this fantastic move by the doctor. Julius in the air, palming it with the right hand, floating, reaching, and spinning it in.
So in a 2013 documentary profiling Erving, Magic Johnson described the move as, quote, the all-time greatest move I've seen, and explained, this is Magic again, when we cut him off baseline, he started walking in the air. He's got the ball in one hand, and we said, wait a minute, he's got to come down. There's no way he can stay in the air that long. So Magic's description of the play 30 years later identifies several of the limits that Erving overcame in the play. Opponents, in this case the defenders who cut him off baseline, the baseline itself, which marks a boundary line set by the rules that Erving must stay within to complete his play. Gravity, which together with Erving's body imposes a limit on how long Dr. J can walk in the air. This last limit comes into play because of another one that Magic doesn't mention. The basketball rule that stipulates that once a player has left his feet with the ball, he must either shoot or pass before coming down, otherwise it's traveling. Magic also doesn't mention that the backboard presents a physical obstacle between Erving and the rim, and that other Lakers defenders guarding Irving's teammates limit his passing options on the play. Taken together, Erving confronts a combination of all of the obstacles we talked about earlier. Now, Irving, in his own recent autobiography, also recalled the play. I'm going to read you his description in a moment, and I'd like you to notice several things. First, the various obstacles that Irving recalls confronting and overcoming in the course of the play. Second, consider that though Irving's description will take me around a minute or so to read, the events he's describing happened in less than 3 seconds. Lastly, note that in describing his mental state in those few seconds, Irving uses words like sense and aware. He's not talking about calculated reasoning. There's no time for that. Rather, a set of fleeting realizations that prompt a succession of improvised adjustments in the face of unfolding obstacles. So here is the doctor's description. I find myself isolated against Mark Landsberger. I'm palming the ball in my right hand, and I have this sense that this is a good situation, since it's Landsberger and not Kareem who's blocking my path. I make one dribble, and I'm at full speed. I rise. I am aware that I have gathered a great deal of momentum, that I am soaring toward the basket. We're probably about a second into the play at this point. I'm looking for a quick dunk, but I've actually picked up so much speed that I've drifted under the basket, and Landsberger has recovered, and he's cutting off the right side of the hoop. So now I'm looking to make an outlet pass to get it to the corner where a shooter would be spotting up, but there's no one in position. And here comes Kareem, and he's got his arms up, and he's bellying me further under the basket. But I have a sense that if his arms are up, then he's not in a position to jump. As I'm flying behind the backboard, I'm aware that I don't have much hang time left. I'm now falling. But I see a little crevice to the reverse side of the hoop. So I bring the ball and flip it up with some backspin so that it banks in. Now, in this same description, Dr. J says it was just another move. But he also framed his description by expressing his admiration for the improvisational genius of jazz musicians like Miles Davis, shown here. Though the doctor explicitly refuses to equate playing basketball with what Miles and other jazz musicians do, he does permit himself a kind of comparison. This is where he says of his move, and this is, I think, really important. It's a form of expression, and like so much art, what makes it beautiful is that I am trying in the moment to transcend the limitations being placed on me by the defenders, by gravity, and by the situation to accomplish the goal. But what also makes it interesting is that any second the baseline move can spin wildly out of control, yet it doesn't. And so there is that tension of any number of possibilities. I get fouled, I fall out of bounds, I miss the shot, I land without shooting, I pass, I lose the ball. And yet when I make the shot, that seems like the only plausible result. If you're like me, Irving's comparison of the move to artistic expression doesn't seem immodest. On the contrary, these are the kinds of plays in sports that regularly inspire us to speak of athletic performance by using terms of art like beauty or grace. So it's not surprising that it was an art critic rather than a sports writer who has written most insightfully about this play. This guy, Dave Hickey, smoking his cigarette there, wrote an essay called The Heresy of Zone Defense, and it opens with a description of the play and his immediate response to it. Here's his response. When Irving makes this shot, I rise into the air and hang there for an instant, held aloft by sympathetic magic. When I return to Earth, everybody in the room is screaming, I gotta see the replay. They replay it, and there it is again. Jesus, what an amazing play. Just the celestial athleticism of it is stunning, but the tenacity and purposefulness of it, the fluid stream of instantaneous micro decisions that go into Irving's completing it, well, it just breaks your heart. It's everything you want to do by way of finishing under pressure, beyond the point of no return, faced with adversity, and I am still amazed when I think of it. Even Kareem, after the game, Hickey recalls, even Kareem remarked that he would pay to see Dr. J make that play against someone else. But then Hickey surprises his reader with a comment that relates directly to this question of limits. He says that Kareem kind of misses the point. Here's what Hickey says. That play was as much Kareem's as it was Irving's, since it was Kareem's perfect defense that made Irving's instantaneous, pluperfect response to it both necessary and possible. Thus the joy, because everyone behaved perfectly, eloquently, with mutual respect, and something magic happened. So first, I'd like you just to notice that the responses I've shared with you of Magic, who was an opponent, of Dr. J himself, who's playing the role of the athlete artist, of Hickey, a fan and observer, are superb examples of a concept I introduced you to a few weeks ago, somaesthetics. So you might want to go back and look at that again now that you have a concrete instance of it. Together, they illuminate how the limits imposed by the rules, the world-class competition, and the laws of physics spurred Irving to marshal everything he'd cultivated during his tens of thousands of hours in order to convert the basket, and in so doing to make us feel the joy of having witnessed something like magic. Sometimes, though, these plays are so magical that we actually disbelieve our eyes or mistrust the play itself. We feel as if the player has somehow violated the rules, even though what they've done is perfectly legal and within the rules of the game. That is why Dave Hickey, when he finishes his reflections, emphasizes, quote, Julius Irving's play was at once new and fair. With this comment, Hickey opens the door for the topic that we're going to take up next week, values. Beauty and novelty, Hickey uses the word new, after all, are values, qualities we value, and that shape how we engage the sports machine and what we look to get out of it. But fairness is also a value, and it reminds me that just a little bit beyond the sort of creative improvisation that overcomes obstacles, like Dr. J's scoop, that transcends limits and even appears to violate physical laws, lie two other ways of challenging the limits of sports. Gamesmanship, which abides by the letter but violates the spirit of sports, and cheating, which violates both. So next week, we're going to look at how values such as excellence, winning, enjoyment, beauty, and fairness, which both participants and spectators bring to their engagement with the sports machine, can affect what comes out of it. I think that's it. So don't forget that you can see Fab Five at the Trotter House on Wednesday at 6:30 and hear some of the players talk about it. And on Thursday at 6:30 in the Robertson Auditorium at Ross, hear a discussion on the black male athlete. Thank you.